You kept that mule, Corferon. Russ kept his kin friends. The lion kept Lufa. Humans, brothers, and foster fathers, saved and raised into legion ranks. But not me. Not Angron, no. Did the Emperor teleport his gold-wrapped custodians down to help me and my army? No. Did he free the warhounds and order them to battle, fight alongside me? No. Did he save my brothers and sisters the way he spared and honored the lion's closest kin? The way he honored Corferon? No, no, and no. No mercy for Angron. Angron the Oathbreaker. Angron the Betrayer.
The Primarchs of his Imperium would shoulder many burdens with their service. Created to lead humanity's greatest armies, to purge the galaxy of heresy and malevolent influence, each Primarch would wrestle control of their inner nature to best lead their legions as exemplars of the Emperor's vision. Yet many of the sons of the Master of Mankind would be afflicted with inner turmoil and prove to be unsalvageable. For today, we shall elucidate one such Primarch whose homeworld influence would forever damn him to a life of pain, fury, and bloodlust. The Lord of the Red Sands, Angron. With the scattering of the Primarchs across the stars, the Primarch of the 12th Legion would land upon the world of Nuceria within close proximity to the Ultima Segmentum. A civilized world ruled by aristocratic tyrants, the technologically advanced civilization, with those self-sufficient, bear a deeply troubling fascination with violence. The impoverished civilians under the ruling elite of the planet hungered to vent their frustrations by observing the misery and suffering of others. Organizing gladiatorial spectacles to distract the populace, the oligarchic nobles would cybernetically enhance their chosen pawns to enact brutal rampages within the gladiator pits. The young Primarch would be discovered by a slaver of the pits, finding the injured boy surrounded by Xenos corpses high in the Deshelika Mountains. Scholars would theorize the assailants to be the Eldari, armed with the forewarning of the scourge that the young boy would bring to the galaxy. Their assassination failed. The corpses of the Xenos would aid in encouraging the slaver to sell his foundling for a high price to the rulers of Nuceria. Brought to the palace of Praxica, within the city of Deshea, the slaver would sell the young warrior to the house of Thal'Kyr. Thrust into battle, barely of the age of a toddler, the child Primarch would, alongside 100 slaves, battle an acid-spewing creature upon the gladiator pit ziggurat. As acid filled the arena, the Primarch would by necessity kill any who took up space on the ever-dwindling platform. Surviving his first battle within the pit, the child would shed a tear for those he had slain to endure his barbaric trial. His promise as a gladiator would see the child ascend to fight within the largest arena of the land and be given the name Angronius Thal'Kyr, Child of the Mountain. Recovering from his wounds, Angron would rapidly grow in size due to his enhanced genetics, and within months become the foremost acclaimed gladiator of Nuceria. The populace of Nuceria would come to cherish the champion of the arena, dubbing the Primarch as the Lord of the Red Sands. After his deeds on the blood-soaked earth of gladiator pits, Angron, whilst physically strong, would also display a profound sense of honor and mercy, sparing the lives of gladiators whom had proven their merit in battle. Angron would slay hundreds of warriors, yet never succumb to his baser instincts. The unbeaten gladiator of Deshea would, despite his circumstance, enjoy the thrill of battle and adulation of his people. Yet in secret, Angron would plot to escape his bonds of slavery, and on many occasions attempt and fail to escape his captors. Mentored by the veteran gladiator of the pits, Oenimus, the old warrior would act as a foster father to the young and impressionable Primarch. Side by side, Angron and Oenimus would slay scores of opponents within the pit. An especially acclaimed victory against a pair of Ogryn berserkers implanted with the deadly contraption known as the Butcher's Nails. Their ample strength further amplified by the cortical implants, the opponents of the Lord of Red Sands would bound into the fray with feral rage and fury. Yet such a victory would sour the efforts of the so-called High Riders of the aristocrats of Nuceria, and soon after, Angron would be pitted against his mentor in combat. Facing one another in a duel to the death, Angron would refuse to fight his father figure. The Primarch's insolence would see him restrained by the guards of the arena, and as punishment, the High Riders would implant the Butcher's Nails within Angron's skull. A relic from the Dark Age of Technology, historical records are unclear as to how the Nucerians came to own such dangerous implants, but what can be gleaned is that their actions would damn countless billions to death across the millennia. Imbued with increased adrenal function, strength, aggression, and overwhelming bloodlust, Angron's path to damnation would begin, blinding all sense of reason or morality within the Primarch's mind. The nails would dig deep until all that would end their inflicted suffering would be the release of blood and viscera. Rewarding violence with spasms of pleasure, Angron would become a living embodiment of rage. The High Riders would test their new feral beast's abilities by releasing Oenimus to face him in combat. Tearing him limb from limb, Angron's hunger for violence would not be sated in his frenzied, berserk state. Regaining clarity after the maiming of his foster father, Angron would quickly wallow in despair at his actions. Howling alike to a feral beast, Angron's wails of sorrow would not end for several days. Angron would swear that one day he shall escape the shackles of the High Riders and achieve vengeance for his manipulation and his father's death. For several years, Angron would train and organize the gladiators of the arena into a brotherhood of warriors. Dominating any challengers chosen to face them, the Dishean gladiators would respect their leader with utter devotion and aid in his plot to escape the arena. Upon the grandest spectacle of the Death Games, the gladiators would make their escape. Assembling the entirety of his men, Angron and his gladiators would enter the arena en masse to rapturous applause. Turning on the arena guards, the gladiators would butcher their wardens and escape the arena among the panicked stampede of the civilian onlookers. Armed with firearms, the remaining arena guards would put down a swathe of the gladiators, armed with swords and scant armor. Yet despite the resistance, 2,000 Dishean gladiators would escape to the mountains of Angron's origins. For years, the rulers would hunt down the gladiators and slowly erode their numbers. Naming themselves the Eaters of Cities, the Dishean gladiators under Angron's command would hold any incursion to capture or slay their band of warriors. However, attrition would slowly see to the dwindling of the Eaters of Cities until their numbers declined to 1,000 men and women. Upon the mountain of Fedan Mor, Angron's band of gladiators would make their final stand. At the Jest Elica Ridge, the Eaters of Cities would be surrounded by 7 armies of Nuceria. Angron and his warriors would be doomed to die in combat, for even a Primarch would be unable to best such an overwhelming force. Yet Angron would not die this day, and with the intervention of the Emperor of Mankind, the Primarch of the 12th Legion would be saved. Observing the Primarch's struggles in secret, the Master of Mankind would watch his son's rebellion from afar. Descending to the battle with a cadre of his custodians, the Emperor would offer his aid in the battle should his son assume the mantle of leadership of the 12th Legion, the Warhounds. Refusing the Emperor's offer, Angron would demand that he remain on Nuceria with his gladiator kin and not withdraw from the planet until his enslavers had been brought to justice. Reluctantly, the Emperor would teleport Angron to his flagship, shocked at the sheer refusal of his son to adopt the responsibility ordained by his word. Finding his son wanting in strategical acumen, the Master of Mankind would not let his irreplaceable son die to the rabble of a backwater planet. The Eaters of Cities would be massacred without the leadership of Angron, to which the Lord of Red Sands would watch their annihilation helplessly from orbit. Lashing out at the custodian guard, Angron would slay one of the Emperor's guardians until the Master of Mankind would use his psychic might to subdue the Primarch. Hoping in time that Angron would understand the realities of why the Emperor had abandoned his band of warriors, the Master of Mankind would seek to salvage the potential of his much beleaguered and scarred son. Angron was a ghost of the Emperor's former plans, yet a Primarch he would remain. For every Primarch would serve the Imperium in the campaigns of the Great Crusade. Embittered to his father's dismissal of his plight, Angron would come to resent the Emperor for his disregard for his honor to die with his men. Nurturing the deep wound in his psyche, the Lord of Red Sands would regardless assume command of his legion, the Warhounds, in an attempt to sate the ever-worsening cravings of the Butcher's Nails. Murdering the captains of his legion and the 12th Legion Master, Ibram Greer, in a fit of rage, Angron's hatred for his stranger sons would be calmed with the intervention of the Legion's 8th Captain, Khan. Volunteering to soothe his Primarch's torment, Khan would be beaten to near death by his gene father. Yet Khan's resolve to never accept defeat would resonate with his Primarch, and for his efforts, a bond between Khan and Angron would form. Convincing his Primarch that the Legion was worthy to honor the legacy of the gladiators of Dashea, Captain Drieger would offer a change in the 12th's title. No longer would they be the Emperor's Warhounds. From then on, they would become the Eaters of Worlds for the Lord of Red Sands. Now known throughout the Imperium as the World Eaters, Angron would lead his men to bring many worlds into compliance into the fold of the Imperium. Incorporating the Nuceraean gladiator cultural trappings into their legion, the World Eaters would become synonymous for their efficient yet bloody deeds. Experts in neurological surgery and cortical implant technologies would study the Primarch's affliction of the Butcher's Nails. Realizing that the implants combined with the Primarch's enhanced biological functions had integrated beyond all hope of removal, Angron's brain had been remapped to incorporate the nail's influence above all other stimuli of his body. Reducing his serotonin neurotransmitters and deadening all emotions beside aggression, Angron's capabilities of reason would be continually lost as the influence of the nails progressed. Removal of the Butcher's Nails would definitely kill the Primarch, yet their continual presence would regardless slowly kill him. The 12th Legion's burdens would be many, as not only was their Primarch slowly dying from his affliction, his reputation as the only Primarch to fail in conquering his homeworld would worsen the World Eater's already infamous reputation. Morale was low within the 12th Legion, yet their purpose as the serrated edge of the Great Crusade would at least give them purpose. Conflict was the only measure of the worth of the World Eaters, for they would earn no glory or plaudits, only satisfaction in battle as warriors. Seeking to emulate their Primarch and become closer to his solitary struggle, the legionaries of the World Eaters would volunteer themselves to undergo the procedure to be implanted with Butcher's Nails of their own devising. Ordering his apothecaries to construct the nails and begin implanting them within his legion, Angron would seek to transform the 12th into warriors befitting the heritage of Nuceria's gladiators. Initially yielding a 100% failure rate, the nails would cause any implanted to die a painful death, yet Angron would not relent in his demands for the nails to be refined and trialed. Abandoning his legion for their weakness to follow in the steps of the gladiators of Dashea, it would take 2 years for his equerry, Khan, to reunite the Lord of Red Sands with his legion. Shedding their weakness, Khan would be the first to survive the Butcher's Nail surgery, and by his example, the Legion would completely integrate the nails into their bodies, or die in the attempt. Observing the rapid devolution of the World Eater's discipline in favor of frenzied rage, detractors of the 12th Legion would let their criticisms be known. Rebute Gilliman, Primarch of the Ultramarines Legion, would be disgusted during his joint campaign alongside Angron during the cleansing of Arigata. Nicknamed the Red Angel, Angron's reputation for committing atrocities would become of great concern to the Imperium. The World Eaters in their frenzied state had hurled themselves into the most unwinnable of odds and enacted a heavy toll of losses for their lack of self-preservation. Ordering his men to bring worlds into compliance within 31 Nuceraean standard hours, upon failure, the Red Angel would execute 1/10 of his men in order to root out the weakness within the Legion. Learning of the Butcher's Nails implantation within the Legion, the Emperor of Mankind would dispatch the Primarch of the 6th Legion, Leman Russ, to order Angron to end his heretical surgeries. Known by Imperial records as the Knight of the Wolf. The Emperor's Executioner, with his legion of Space Wolves, would confront the World Eaters after the massacre of the planet of Genna. Refusing the orders of the Wolf King, Angron and Leman Russ would battle. The Fenrisian Chainsword, Krakenmoor, would clash against Angron's Chain Axe, Widowmaker. Each legion would claim that the other fired the first shot that would begin the melee, but all that bears remembering is that there would be no clear victor of the skirmish. Widowmaker would be destroyed at the hands of the Wolf King, yet Angron would assert his victory in combat against the restrained might of Leman Russ. Yet Angron would assert his victory in combat against the restrained might of the Wolf King. Withdrawing from battle, despite their censure and warning of the Imperium, the World Eaters would continue their Butcher's Nails implantation. Claiming the skulls of their foes from battle, the World Eaters would not relent in their ever-worsening onslaught across the galaxy. The Imperium would ignore the barbarity of the 12 Legion's actions should they continue to enforce the will of the Emperor. Yet such oversight would prove to be devastating to the future of the Imperium, with the dawn of the Civil War for Humanity's Soul, the Horus Heresy. Corrupted by the thrall of the ruinous powers, the Warmaster and Primarch of the 16th Legion, Horus Lupercal, would begin his quest to end the reign of the Emperor. Before his duplicity would be known, the Master of Mankind would send the Warmaster to confront Angron for his actions during the Great Crusade. Offering the Lord of Red Sands a chance at vengeance against his most hated father, it would not take much of Horus's lauded charisma to convince Angron to join the rebellion of the traitor Primarchs. Culling the loyalist elements within his legion, Angron would once more seek to purge any sign of weakness from within his ranks. Among the first members of the Pact of Betrayal, the World Eaters would stand at the forefront of the war for humanity. Joining the second wave of traitors during the Dropside Massacre of Istvan V, Angron would relish the chance to slay the loyalists to the throne. Proving to be instrumental in the vanguard of the traitor war effort, Angron's rampages across the stars would seemingly be destined to succeed. As the Word Bearers and World Eaters joined forces to engage the Ultramarines within their home system of Ultramar, their so-called Shadow Crusade would slow the advance of the Imperium's most numerically superior and lauded legion. Yet with every battle fueled by the sting of the Butcher's Nails, Angron's terminal affliction would worsen. Attempting to heal his brother, the Primarch of the Word Bearers, Lorgar Aurelian, would beseech the Red Angel to return to his homeworld of Nuceria. Due to its close proximity within the Ultima Segmentum, the Urizen would hope to confront the High Riders of Nuceria, and with Angron by his side, find a means to remove the Butcher's Nails from his afflicted brother. At last given an opportunity to bring his enslavers to justice, Angron and his World Eaters would venture to Nuceria. Upon the arrival of the 12th and 17th Legions to the planet of Nuceria, Angron would descend once more to the Deshelika Ridge of the mountains. Paying his respects to his fallen brothers in arms, Angron would collect the skulls of his former brethren and adorn them across his armor. Confronting the High Riders of Deshea, Angron would be enraged at their disrespect of the retelling of the deaths of his noble gladiators. The populace believed Angron to have fled the battle and left his men to die in disgrace. Incensed by the lies of the High Riders, Angron would order his men to execute every living soul within the city and, once finished, commit genocide across the planet. Yet the Lord of Red Sand's plot to annihilate his people would be halted by the Ultramarines commanded by their Primarch, Rebute Gilliman. The Retribution Fleet of Ultramar would battle the combined might of the World Eaters and Word Bearers, both in orbit and on the planet's surface. The Lord of Ultramar would battle Lorgar Aurelian in single combat, and after a bitter clash, come close to ending the Urizen's life. However, Angron would not allow Gilliman to end the life of the bearer of the word. Unleashing his fury against the Lord of Ultramar, Angron would, despite his might, receive a glancing blow from Gilliman's power fist. A skull of Angron's once dead gladiators would fall from his armor, and Gilliman would unwittingly crush it beneath his mighty ceramite boot. Surrendering fully to his anguish, Angron would once more launch himself into the fray. feeling the malevolent power of the warp in the wake of Angron's boundless grief, emanating from beyond the veil of the mortal realm. Chanting heretical litanies and imbuing Angron with the fury of the Blood God, Lorgar would enact the ascension of the Lord of Red Sands into a demon prince of Khorne. His torment, rage and despair, coalescing into the form of a demonic being of unimaginable wrath, the Red Angel would achieve apotheosis. Withdrawing from the battle, the Ultramarines and their Primarch would retreat in horror at the sight of the being birthed on the planet of Nuceria. Lorgar had saved his brother from the clutches of death, yet in doing so, damned countless future souls to suffer at the hands of the reborn Red Angel. Ordering Khan to butcher the slaves within the hold of the World Eater's flagship, Conqueror, the Demon Prince of Khorne would demand a throne of skulls to be built in his honor. Rampaging throughout the galaxy in his now ascended form, Angron's hunger for blood would not be sated by the lesser mortals and fiefdoms of the stars. Only the blood of humanity's most cherished bastion and its ruler would be fitting for such a horrific being. Brought to assemble with the traitor Primarchs at the world of Ulanor by the Primarch of the Iron Warriors, Perturabo, the World Eaters would once more lead the charge to Holy Terra. Creating a gigantic warp rift above the moon of Luna, Angron and his World Eaters would be the initial hammer blow of the traitor advance. Perched atop the Conqueror, Angron would observe the bloodletting of his legion with grim satisfaction. Enslaved to the whims of the Blood God, Khorne, Angron would assault the Imperial Palace during the Siege of Terra as a terrible Angel of Vengeance. Slaying friend and foe alike, Angron's massacre of any who stood in his path would be terrible and uncompromising in its savagery. Destroying the defenses of the Lionsgate spaceport and Eternity Wall, even the bravest of souls would fall to the fell Black Blade and its malevolent wielder before its edge would crash through the great gate of the Imperial Palace. Yet despite the efforts of the World Eaters, would need to hasten their assault. Wary of the ever closer arrival of the Dark Angels, Space Wolves, and Ultramarines to Holy Terra, the War Master would confront the Emperor in single combat. The Emperor would defeat Horus Lupercal and destroy his very being from existence. The armies of Chaos would fragment and retreat from the Siege of Terra, to which Angron, though the last to withdraw, would be no exception. Seeking refuge within the Eye of Terra, the World Eaters would over the millennia abandon their Primarch and fragment into several warbands. His last great revenge against the Master of Mankind thwarted, Angron skulks the Immaterium and bides his time for his seemingly random conquests of distant worlds. Prosecuting wars in the name of his patron god, Angron would be banished from the material realm during the Dominion of Fire campaign and First War for Armageddon. Yet with the return of the long-dormant Primarch of the Ultramarines, Rabute Gilliman, rumors stir that the Red Angel shall once again return to real space during the Era Indomitus. Further transformed into a being of unrelenting fury, whose death grants only a momentary reprieve before his inevitable return, the Lord of Red Sands shall not cease his campaign of bloodshed and butchery. For in the grim darkness of the far future, there is only war, and the Red Angel shall delight in every death made in the name of conflict across the stars.
What brought you so low, brother? Did the machine in your skull finally refashion your loyalty into madness? They let me dream. They give me peace. What would you know of struggle, perfect son? When have you fought against the mutilations of your mind? When have you had to do anything more than tally compliances and polish your armor?
Childish,
Gilliman sighed, gesturing to the burning, dying city.
Does it really come down to this?
So pitiably childish.
Childish? The people of your world named you Great One. The people of mine called me slave.
Angron stepped back, chainsaws revving harder.
Which one of us landed on a paradise of civilization to be raised by a foster father, Rabute? Which one of us was given armies to lead after training in the halls of the Macragian High Riders? Which one of us inherited a strong, cultured kingdom?
Angron splayed blood as he frothed the words.
And which of us had to rise up against a kingdom with nothing but a horde of starving slaves? Which one of us was a child enslaved on a world of monsters, with his brain cut open by carving knives?
The two Primarchs met again. Gilliman's powered gauntlets should have easily deflected Angron's chainswords, but the World Eater's strength drove his brother back step by step. Chain teeth sprayed from the weapons as eagerly as the saliva from Angron's lipless slit of a mouth.
Listen to your blue-clad wretches yelling of courage and honor. Courage and honor, do you even know the meaning of those words? Courage is fighting the kingdom that enslaves you, no matter that their armies overshadow yours by 10,000 to 1. You know nothing of courage. Honor is restraining a tyrant when all others suckle and grow fat on the hypocrisy he feeds them. You know nothing of honor.
This has been a tale of the Great Imperium of Man, read by the Remembrancer. Angron would be the epitome of the cursed bargains bequeathed by the ruinous powers. For while their gifts may grant power to their subjects, they shall be tormented forevermore as slaves to their impulses and desires. For in my next transmission, we shall elucidate a Primarch, though resistant to the thrall of chaos, would nonetheless succumb to its tainted embrace. The bitter and caustic lord of death, Mortarion.